Hello?
Okay.
John chapter 8. Yes. You guys have met my friends from college, the two lovely ladies in the back, Stephanie in the blonde hair and Beth in the brown hair. They're my friends from Bible school. We were in the same club together, missionary club, and they're just great sisters. Stephanie is a missionary, and she was in Kosovo near Macedonia, near Greece, for the past 3 years, and strong sister. So please get to know her if you have a chance. And then my friend Beth, she's been living in Hagi. Where is that? In Yamaguchi. The past 3 years? 3 years now? So, strong sister. So please say hello to them if you have a chance. Get to know them a little bit. It's great having you guys come here and visit my church. Yes. So I feel blessed just to see them. My family hasn't come yet. It's been 5 years. Actually, this week is my 5th year anniversary to come to Hiroshima. I've been here. I still can't speak Japanese. Can't read the signs. That I can eat okonomiyaki. That's okay. So good, real good. I've been reading the New Testament these days since the springtime. Just started the New Testament. As a Christian, some of you have just become Christians, or maybe been Christian for a while, but you know, you read the Bible throughout your life. And there are times when you'll read the New Testament a lot. You'll just read through that maybe a year or, you know, half of a year. It takes a while. And then you're just like, wow, this is great. New Testament, it's so rich, so much meaning. Sometimes one verse, one chapter is enough for 1 week. You know, it takes a long time. It's a great part of the Bible. And then you finish the New Testament and you start again into the Old Testament, the time before Jesus came. And it's like you read the story, you read the history, and you learn the meanings and you think, wow, it's so big. And you understand some of the names, you know, the names in the New Testament. Why did they have some of those names, and why those customs and traditions, well, they started in the Old Testament. And so when you read the Old Testament, there's more meaning now. And then after you read the Old Testament a while, you go back to the New Testament. And it opens up again. Because you've been reading the Old Testament, you understand the names, you understand the traditions, you understand the reasons and things and the places. And you notice the things in the New Testament again that maybe you didn't notice the first time, because you understand a little bit more from the Old Testament. It's great. And you go back and forth throughout your whole life. It's such a big book, you know, the Word of God. And when you read the Old Testament and the New Testament, it's like you're reading it for the first time sometimes, if you haven't read one part in a long time. And that's how it's been for me. I haven't read the New Testament in a while. And I'm just starting again, and I'm noticing things that I hadn't noticed before. And it's like reading the New Testament for the first time. It's great. And so I was reading the book of John a few weeks ago. And I noticed something that I had usually just run over, just read on through, and this time I was reading, and this verse, this word that Jesus said was just strong, just wow. good. And I hadn't read it before. Well, I had read it before, but I hadn't heard it before in the same way. Maybe you have that experience sometimes. And it's in John chapter 8. Repeat after me. John 8.
John 8.
All right, so we are all there. Starting at verse 31. And I'm going to read until verse 47. In this chapter, John chapter 8, it's a good chapter. It's one of my favorite chapters. It's so good. There's a lot of good chapter 8s in the Bible. Romans chapter 8. John chapter 8. Good. Luke chapter 8. And there's a story in there at the beginning where there's a woman, she's caught in adultery, sexual sin, and they bring her in front of Jesus, and Jesus lets her go free, and it's just forgiveness and grace. And it's like, every time I read it, every time, it's just, ugh, God is so full of grace. I love it. And then it goes on, and basically the chapter is Jesus versus the Pharisees. Repeat after me. Pharisees! Yeah. Jesus versus the Pharisees. This whole chapter. It's an argument. They're fighting between the Pharisees and Jesus. And who are the Pharisees? I'll get into that a little bit more later on into the sermon, but that's the situation, is that Jesus is having this vicious, ugly fight, argument with the Pharisees. They were the religious leaders of the time of Jesus. And so we're going to jump right into the middle of that argument, starting in verse 31. Let me read it for you. To the Jews who had believed him, Jesus said, "If you hold to my teaching, you are really my disciples. Then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." Somebody say, amen. That's some good stuff. They answered him, they, the Pharisees, "We are Abraham's descendants and have never been slaves of anyone. How can you say that we shall be set free?" And Jesus replied, "I tell you the truth. Everyone who sins is a slave to sin. Now a slave has no permanent place in the family, but a son belongs to it forever. So if the son sets you free, you will be free indeed." Amen. "I know you are Abraham's descendants." Yeah, I know. Yet you are ready to kill me because you have no room for my word. I am telling you what I have seen in the Father's presence, and you do what you have heard from your father." "Abraham is our father," they answered. "If you were Abraham's children," said Jesus, "then you would do the things Abraham did. As it is, you are determined to kill me, and a man who has told you the truth that I heard from God. Abraham did not do such things. You are doing the things your own father does." "We are not illegitimate children," they protested. "The only father we have is God himself." Jesus said to them, "If God were your father, you would love me, for I came from God and now am here. I have not come on my own, but he sent me. Why is my language not clear to you? Because you are unable to hear what I say. You belong to your father, the devil, and you want to carry out your father's desire. He was a murderer from the beginning, not holding to the truth, but there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks his native language, for he is a liar and the father of lies." Verse 45. "Yet because I tell the truth, you do not believe me. Can any of you prove me guilty of sin? If I am telling the truth, why don't you believe me?" Verse 47. "He who belongs to God hears what God says. The reason you do not hear is that you do not belong to God." He who belongs to God hears what God says. The reason you do not hear is because you do not belong to God. Today's sermon is simply about hearing from God, listening to what God says in our life. Why? Because He has something to say to us. Because God is speaking to us all the time. Because as Christians, we cannot live without hearing from God. In our lives, there are times and there are places when we have to make big decisions. Do I go this way? Or do I go that way? Do I do this thing? Or do I choose that thing? What do I do with my life? What do I do with my future? There's big decisions that we have to make. And so we listen, right? We ask advice to people that we trust, people who are wise, people that we think would give us good advice. And so, of course, we need to listen to God and hear what He has to say. Or sometimes there's times in our lives where there can be just, it's a crisis. It's hard. An emergency. And you think, oh man, I need to hear from God right now. This is an immediate situation, urgent. I need to hear Your voice, God, or I'm not going to move forward in this. I can't. It's a crisis, and you know, it's confusing, and it's, you're spinning around, and you don't know what's going on. You need to hear God just to get your bearing. Okay, which way is up? We need to hear God. And those who belong to God hear what God says. Or sometimes in our lives, you know, we get to a point where at first, I mean, it was so easy to hear God, you know. It was like, yeah, you read the Bible, it's right there. It's pretty obvious what God is saying, or you were just walking and, you know, it was easy to hear God all the time, listening to Him and just obeying and going. But maybe sometimes in our lives we get out of that, you know, and we enter this kind of season where it's, what's going on? I used to hear God. Where are You? There's a line in a song. You used to be, You were closer than my skin, but now You're as far away as the moon. It's like, God, I can't live like this. This is not me. I can't do life without hearing from You. And sometimes we're at that point. But Jesus says, he who belongs to God hears what He says. There are other times where you're just thinking your thoughts, thinking about the daily things, and something comes to you, a thought, some kind of feeling, and you're like, it's not me who's thinking that. Is that God, is that You? Are You speaking to me? Are You saying something to me? Or is that maybe just something I ate, like some bad sushi or something, right? You ever have that happen? Just some bad sushi? Maybe not. But, yeah. Hearing God. And so the questions, there's lots of questions, right? How do we know it's God? How do we know if it's just me or if it's really God? Or God, I'm in this situation. Which way do I go? Left or right? Is it up or down? Is it this or that? I need to hear from You, God. Or God, in this crisis, in this time of my life, this emergency, God, I can't move without You. I'm waiting, God, to hear from You. Or is it just, God, are You even there? Are You even there? Do You even know I'm here? I'm waiting to hear from You. There's lots of questions. Lots of questions. And I don't expect to answer all of that in this one sermon, this one afternoon, in the next 15 minutes. And I've decided to make this a little bit. But today I just want to take the first steps into teaching us how to hear from God. Hearing from God. And I'm going to cover ways that God speaks to you through this way or through that way, through this method or or whatever, and in ways you can listen to God, you know, and doing this or doing that. And there's lots of ways that God speaks. It's all throughout the Bible, God speaking, God's, you know, people hearing God. But we cannot get anywhere. We cannot do anything in hearing God until we understand this one principle about hearing God. And that is, he who belongs to God hears what God says. He who belongs to God hears what God says. You want to hear from God? Well, the question is, do you belong to God? Because he who belongs to God hears what God says. Do you belong to God? I use this example many times, and you might be tired of hearing me talk about it. But my life is very simple. I don't have much. And so I just talk about a few things. So I'm going to talk about my computer again. And for some of you, you know, I got my first computer this year, and I'm very happy about it. It's a wonderful little laptop. And on the outside, it says Dell. It's a Dell computer. And you open it up, a little sticker. It says Microsoft. Right? And underneath, there's a bunch of other numbers and names. But when you push the button and you turn it on, Mozart, and you press the start button on the menu, you know, start menu. You know, usually, most of you use computers. Usually it says, my computer, right? My files, my computer. It doesn't say my computer. It says Chris's computer. And when you push the start menu, it goes up, it says, this is Chris's start menu. And you push the other buttons, it doesn't say my file. It says Chris's file. My music, no. Chris's music, Chris's photos, Chris's documents. So there's names all over the computer. Outside, you open it up. But the name that's registered is Chris. It's my computer. That computer belongs to me. You may have a name. You may have a nickname. You may have three or four nicknames. You may be wearing labels. All kinds of things on you. You have positions and titles. But what name is written on your heart? Who does your heart, your life, belong to? That's the question, because he who belongs to God hears what he says. Whose name is written there? Is it you? Who does your life belong to? Does your life belong to your company, your boss? Or does it belong to God? Does your life belong to your family? Maybe someone you love? Or does it belong to God? Maybe you wouldn't admit this, but does your life belong to your money? Or does your life belong to your God? Who does your life belong to? When God pushes that button and he turns you on, and he wants to get inside, who gets inside? You or God? You know, also, in my computer, anybody can use my computer. You know, it's open to everyone. But there's some places you can't get into because you need a password. Right? There's some files that are top secret. They're my files. You want to get in there? You need the password. Do you have the password? No, you don't. Because it's not your computer. It's Chris's computer. Who has the password in your life? Who gets into the secret places? Who gets into the place that no one else can get into? Is it someone you love? Or is it God? To whom does that password belong? Because he who belongs to God hears what God says. Who has that part? Who can push that button that gets right into the very heart of you? Also, on my computer, I have Internet Explorer, a great program. And when you push the Explorer button, the screen pops up. And does everybody know what favorites is? The favorites button, the little star. And it's your settings, right? You can the internet sites that you visit the most or most often are your favorites. And you push the button and there's a whole list of your favorite internet sites. Do you have this? Yes? Just nod yes. Or you can sleep, whatever you want. But yeah, it's there. And so when I push that button, is it the first thing on the list? Can you guess the first part? It's the sports, of course. That's my computer. So it's sports, and it's got the basketball news, ESPN, you know, Sports Illustrated and everything. And the next is church? No, news. So news and music, and then church. Okay, I'm on my favorites list. They're my settings. So that when my computer is turned on, the things that I always use on my computer, the places that I always go habitually, naturally, every time, daily, are according to my pattern, my settings, because my computer belongs to me. Well, how about the patterns, the habits, and the settings in your life? Who do they belong to? Are they your patterns, your habits, or are they God? Are they God? Because he who belongs to God hears what God says. Who sets your habits? Who sets your personal daily schedule? You, your company, the one you love, your children, husband, wife, boyfriend, girlfriend, or is it God? Who does your daily schedule belong to? Ask that question, because if you can answer it, then you will know if you can hear from God or not, because he who belongs to God hears what God says. He who belongs to God hears what God says. So does that mean, here's a question, does that mean God only speaks to those who belong to him? Is that what that means? He who belongs to God hears what God says. So does that mean God only speaks to those who belong to him? I think you know the answer. The answer is no. God speaks to everyone, everybody, all the time. In Romans chapter 10, verse 11, says, everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. The same Lord is Lord of all and richly blesses all who call upon his name. Anyone who trusts in him will not be put to shame. So God is speaking to everyone. You don't have to be a Christian for God to speak to you. You don't have to be religious, or you don't have to go to Mitaki only just for God to speak to you. God speaks to everyone. But not everyone hears from God, because he who belongs to God hears what he says. So God will speak to anybody who's willing to listen. And the question is, who belongs to God? Who belongs to God? religious people? I mean, you know, ask the question, do you belong to God? And you can say, well, look, where am I? I'm in church. I'm here, aren't I? I'm a Christian. I do believe in Jesus. I grew up in a Christian family. I was baptized. But the question is not, what do you believe? What church do you go to? What kind of family did you come from? The question is, do you belong to God? That's the question. Everything in your life, does it belong to God? Because you could be very religious. You could go to church every Sunday. You could do some great ministry, something, but still not hear from God. In fact, you know, that's what the Pharisees thought. The Pharisees were basically like us. They were very religious people. In fact, the most religious people of the time. The Pharisees themselves, you know, they believed the same things that we believed. You understand that? The things that the Pharisees believed, that you could raise to life after you died, that there was life after death, that there was eternal life. The Pharisees believed that God was a personal God and wants to be in your life. The Pharisees believed that if you lived your life wholly to God, He was going to bless you and work in your life. We believe those things. The Pharisees believed that you have to give everything you have to God. The Pharisees were missionaries. They wanted to share the grace and love of God to everybody. They would take anybody who would come into their temples, into their synagogues. Synagogues was like the church, the temples. Just same things we do. Same things we believe. Those were the Pharisees. They were right there with us. In fact, you know, the person who influences our thinking the most, the one who wrote so much of the New Testament that we study all the time, Paul, he was a Pharisee. Very religious. But God was right there speaking to them in their presence. They could see Him. They could touch Him. They could smell Him. God was doing amazing things right there in their time, but they couldn't hear Him. They couldn't hear God. He was right there. But they loved God as much as we did. Why not? Why couldn't the Pharisees hear? Well, let's look at verse 31, chapter 8. Jesus is preaching, verse 31. To the Jews who had believed Him, if you hold to My teachings, you will really be My disciples and you will know the truth. The truth will set you free. Jesus is preaching. And then suddenly the Pharisees go, wait. Just a moment, Jesus. We are Abraham's children. We've never been slaves of anyone. You see, these religious people, they have an answer for everything. God could be speaking to them, but they know the Scriptures. They know the Bible. And they just have an answer for whatever God says. Usually, the people who have been in the church the longest, they've grown up, they know the Bible, they know the stories and everything in it. Those are the ones who usually have an excuse for everything God says to them. They take God's word and they twist it and they manipulate it. But, you know, God could be speaking to them, but they say, well, God, but what about this? So-and-so, this pastor said this. And, oh, but the Scriptures say that. And the Bible, I mean, what about this? And they have all these excuses not to obey God because they know it so much. The Pharisees, they knew the Bible so well. The Pharisees, they were going to Bible school since they were young. The first five books of the Bible, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, they knew it in their hearts. They knew the Bible like we know the train schedules here. They know just exactly what you'll find when you need it. And so when God gives them when God was speaking to them, they wouldn't want to hear it because they could just manipulate scriptures that way. And God could be speaking to you. But you could just go, wait, hold on. See, Jesus was just getting warmed up. He said two or three. He was just getting, oh man, the truth. Be my disciples and you'll know the truth. The truth will set you. And people, they're getting warmed up. And Pharisees, wait, hold. We are Abraham's children. And you see, when people make excuses to God, they'll make these excuses. They'll say, I'm Abraham's child. Do you know who I am, God? Do you know who you're talking to? I know who I am. God, you may be asking me to do this, or you may be telling me that. But, you know, God, that's just not my... I've been a Christian. I know who I am as a Christian. I know who I am in this family of God. And that's just not me, what you're asking me to do. It's not me. God, I'm just tired. Or God, it's not what I do. And they use, any excuse they have. And then, here's the part that kind of blows me away. The next thing they say is, we have never been slaves of anyone. What? Never been slaves of anyone. We are Abraham's children. We've never been slaves of anyone. Now that's just a lie. That's just not true. Right? And if you know the story, who's Abraham? There's Abraham, and his son was Isaac, right? And Isaac's son was Jacob, right? And Jacob had 12 sons. And those 12 sons had many children, and they became Israel. They became the people of God. And there was a time in their history where there was a famine. They went hungry. There was no food, no rain. So they went to Egypt, and they stayed in Egypt, and they stayed there for 400 years, the people of Israel, the people of Abraham. And in that time, they became slaves. I mean, how could the Pharisees not know that? They were Abraham's children. How does that truth just slip out of their mind? How does that happen? In fact, the most important day of the year, the Passover, was to celebrate when God took them out of slavery. And they say, we have never been slaves of anyone. Does that make sense to you? It's just a lie. But that's what people will do if they don't want to hear from God. They'll just say anything. In fact, half of what they said was true, right? We are Abraham's children. That's true. But the other half was just not true. We've never been slaves of anyone. So that's what people do sometimes. If we don't want to hear God, we'll say a half-truth, right? Just to make an excuse. And a half-truth, what is that? That's a lie. And we'll just make up anything just so that we don't have to hear what God says. And God is right there. It's so obvious. Jesus was making miracles right in front of them, speaking to them right in their temple, and they couldn't hear it. And there was a... it's like they were only listening for what they wanted to hear. It's called selective listening. I choose what I will hear from God. And I will choose or select what I won't hear from God. And if you're just listening for one thing from God and not hearing anything else that God is saying, God might as well be speaking a whole other language. It's just, a waste of time. What was it? Friday. I went to the Kuyaku show, right? You know what the Kuyaku show is? It's the city ward office. It's like city hall, but for this part, because I had to register my new visa status I changed jobs. So when I was working for an English conversation school, I was a humanities specialist. But now I'm a teacher at Hiroshima College of Foreign Languages. So now I'm an instructor. That's my visa status. Instructor Habakkuk. So I had to go to Kuyakusho, the ward office, and register all that and do a couple more other errands. And when I go there, I mean, I don't know the Japanese so well, so I call my boss. Boss, I'm going to the Kuyakusho and I need to know how to say I'm changing my visa status. And shikaku henko. Okay, shikaku henko, got it, I'm written down. And I want to stop using the national health insurance and do the private health insurance. Okay, that's kokumin hoken no dakkai tetsuzuki shitai desu ka? Something like that. Okay, got that. And I go there and I have my paper of this is what I want to say, right? And if they say something like this, we're on the same language, same wavelength, and we're communicating. If they say what I want to say and I say what they, I need to say, that's, me and the government. So I go there and I shikaku henko desu. I just say that. Okay, right. And they usually have a form I have to fill out. And if they say certain things that I know, okay, we're okay. Like, here it's your gonamae, right? My name. Here it's gojusho. My address, got it. You should remember my Dema bango, right? Phone number, okay, no problem. Seinen gapi, birthday, right? You're right, seinen gapi, birthday. And then he'll say, mayanayan. And I'll just stare at the paper. I'm like, excuse me, my friend. Nani-nani-nani-nani. And there's just this moment of just sweat coming down. What does that mean? And they'll just start talking. I don't know what they're saying. Because at the ward office, they're speaking government Japanese. I don't speak government Japanese. I speak Hiroshima Ben. Right? If they start talking to me in Hiroshima Ben, hey, no problem. But they speak this government Japanese. I don't understand anything. I'm nothing happened. And then basically, I just have to write my name again. That's all they're saying is, write your name again, here. And we do that with God. We want to hear about something. But God is trying to say something to us about another thing. God is saying, look. No, you're saying, God, I'm here. I want to hear about this decision. God, I'm listening. I'm waiting. God, do I go that way or do I do this thing with my life? God, if you could just, resolve this situation with me and this person, if you could just come, we need some kind of peace, or God, I just need something to hear from you about this thing. And God is saying, no, I'm over here. I'm talking to you about this situation. It doesn't matter so much about what you're doing there or what you're going to do at this time. What I want to talk to you about is something right here, right inside. Because it doesn't matter whether you go this way or that way. I want to deal with this thing in your heart right now. And we're selective. God, I just want, if you would just talk to me about this thing. God is saying, listen, we'll take care of that. That's nothing to me. That's easy. But we will get there once you start listening about this thing, about the other things in your life. That's secondary. And that's what the Pharisees were doing. They wanted to hear God only about certain things. If Jesus would do the right things and not do the wrong things, then he was really God. And God, if you would just do it my way, if you would just speak the message I'm looking for, then we're on the right track. But God is saying, look, I'm talking to you. I'm giving you all these messages, but it's not about what you're trying to hear. And we're just like, God, I'm not hearing it. And that's what the Pharisees were doing. And they were the most religious people. If anybody belonged to God, it was the Pharisees. No doubt, it was the Pharisees. If anybody should have heard from God, it should have been the Pharisees. Because they belong to God. And he who belongs to God hears what God says. And so we should be hearing from God sometimes. And we're being so religious, but we can't. So that's the message. We can't go anywhere. We can't hear anything God says unless we belong to God, because he who belongs to God hears what God says. And so, the message is, we studied a little bit about Jesus' argument with the Pharisees, going back and forth, but it's not really what Jesus is saying to the Pharisees. It's really about what is Jesus saying to you. And he's asking the question, do you belong to me? Does your life belong to me? Does everything, your job, your future, your past, your pain, your loved ones, your family, does everything belong to me? If one thing doesn't belong to me, you're not going to hear what I'm going to say to you, because he who belongs to God hears what God says. I want everything. And maybe it's like, God, I'm waiting. Why aren't you saying anything? I'm here. I'm quiet. Everything's shut down. I'm focused. I'm reading the Bible. Speak to me. And maybe God is it. Maybe he's asking you. Son, you could go this way, but if you go this way, is your life still mine? Son, you could go that way. If you go that way, is your life still mine? You say, oh God, it's all yours. Of course, my life. I gave it up to you when I was baptized. I gave it to you on Sunday. I give it to you all the time. And God is saying, well, how about right now? How about right now? Is your life mine? Because he who belongs to God hears what God says. I hope that this church, we as a congregation, are people who listen to God. That would be great if we were a people that heard from God. And I know that we desperately, desperately want to hear from them about everything that we do. But the first thing we have to settle before we do anything, to settle in our hearts, do we belong to him? Whose name is written on my heart? Who owns my money? Who owns my job? Who owns my future? Who owns my past? Who owns my relationships? Because he who belongs to God, here's what God says. Amen? So let's spend some time in prayer. Nozo, if you could lead us in the last song. Why not? Spend some time in prayer with the Lord. Ask yourself, Lord, do I really belong to you? If there's something in your life still waiting to give to God, if there's something maybe you're holding something back, but you're still waiting to hear from him. He who belongs to God hears what he says. It's not about how religious you are, what church you go to, how long you've been a Christian, what you believe. The question is, do you belong to God? Spend a moment in prayer. Heavenly Father, we ask that you would speak to us. We want to hear from you, Lord, about our situation, about our relationships, about our futures, about our decisions, about this crisis in our life, about our loved ones. Lord, speak to us. But Lord, if there's something that we still need to hear about, Lord, if there's another thing, if there's parts of us we haven't given up to you, oh God, show it to us that we can give it to you today, here and now. God, we want to be a people who hear you. We want to be a people that belong to you. Father, if there's pride in the way, Lord, humble us. Oh God, if there's too much pain and resentment or bitterness, oh God, have mercy. Take it away from us, Lord God. Remove it, Lord. We believe that Jesus, you came and you touched people and you made them whole. You helped them see. You made them walk. You gave them new life. You forgave them of their sins. Lord, give us new life. Help us to see. Help us to walk again. Heal us, Lord God. Give us new life, Lord. We want to hear from you, Lord. Oh God, that we would hear you. Let's all stand up as we sing the last song, Power of Your Love. Let's sing this in Jesus' name.
Lord, I come to you. Let my heart be changed, renewed, coming from the grave. Then I found you.
God, as we go from this place, Lord, lead us in the power of your love. Help us to walk in your grace, walk in your strength, walk in your truth. that we would hold to your teachings, that we would be your disciples, that we would know the truth, and the truth would set us free. Oh, God, be with us this week. Lord God, we trust in you. Lord, we just admit we can't do anything without you, without the power that you have in our lives. Oh, God, fill us up with your Holy Spirit as we go. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Turn to somebody left or right and say, glad you came today. Go ahead.